A guy did the right thing and went to his local hobby store to pick up this 1970 Chevelle kit. It's not a 72, and it's an SS, not a Malibu. I'm sure they are the same. Probably not. I have not built a car kit since I was 12. That's fine. This is going to be a budget build, so I'm not going to follow a lot of the details of the actual Chevelle. I'm going to build this kit mostly as it came from the factory. I just ain't got the time. I'm also kind of lacking on the talent. This is a little more of a painting experiment. I might get back into building some other cars, and I thought this would be a good start. So no racing seats, and the grill is wrong. And I'm sure a lot of other stuff isn't going to match the original. If a feller is not sure what's going on here, scooch on over to the Vice Grip Garage channel. This guy Derek takes abandoned cars that have sat for 30 years and makes them run. This particular build is of a 1972 Chevelle that Derek got running after it sat for 30 years. Something about this build series really got people's attention. It was the patriotic paint job and the quirks and oddities, such as the one black fender and the weird circles on the trunk. As I said, I haven't built a car kit since I was about 12, and these kits are really kind of marketed to kids. Building the kit is pretty easy if you want to do an okay job, but it's pretty difficult to do a really good job. So this gave me a lot more respect for the people who are able to build this to contest level quality. My build is pretty much stock, and I'm not going to show a lot of it because it's not that exciting. This is mostly an exercise in painting. The only channel where I've ever seen these kits built is on that HPI guy's workshop, and I think he builds them mostly straight from the box. The build is pretty simple, but you can tell the molds are old. There's some flash and sprue lines. But the parts mostly fit together. I did have some trouble with the final assembly, and you'll see that later in the video. I hope Derek is properly managing his trademark registrations so he can license this machine to Round 2 for a proper model. If you make it over to his channel, subscribe and hit the notification button. It does something. So grab yourself some cold snacks and sit back and see how this build turns out. Now it's time to take care of the weight reduction and add the speed holes, and I'm going to do that with the Dremel tool. The plastic was a little bit thicker than I expected, so it turned out to be a little more difficult than I thought it was going to be. I ended up really using about three different bits. I used the burr bit, the sanding drum, and also one of the grinding wheels. You want to use a relatively low speed setting so you don't melt the plastic. Ideally, what you want to do is thin out the plastic to the point where you can kind of see through it, and then come back with an X-Acto knife and cut away any holes that you want. But sometimes you can also get a good effect by just grinding away all the way through and making your own holes. The risk of grinding your way through the plastic is it may just look like you melted your way through. These are the colors I'm using for my build. If you haven't seen the original, you might think that this is kind of an odd choice, but in the original, the colors are pretty faded. Apparently, the car was painted the red, white, and blue scheme in the early 80s. So the hard part here is going to be painting the body. It starts with a coat of Tamiya primer, so that's the gray. This red color is also a primer. But one of the reasons I wanted to use the Tamiya primer underneath was I was going to do some sanding to wear down the paint, and I wanted to have a gray layer that I could hit before I got down right to the pure white plastic. I really wanted to make sure I wasn't going to sand down all the way to the white. Sanding down to the gray is bad, but nowhere near as bad as sanding to the white. For the interior and the chassis, everything starts out black. After the spray of red, I gave the whole thing a spray of Testor's dull coat. This is partly to protect the paint from being pulled off from the masking tape when I remove the tape. Also, I am going to be sanding through the white to show the red, and I want to have a little bit of a protective layer to prevent sanding through and exposing the gray primer underneath. Now it's time to start masking off to paint the white. I'm using Tamiya masking tape for the initial masking areas. If you're going to try and do a build like this and copy the original, pay attention to the captain's side and the drinker's side because the stripes are alternate colors on each side. One of the tips I've heard when spraying on stripes like this or anything that's masked is that you want to pull off the masking tape as soon as possible. That way the paint does not bleed underneath the masking tape. If you leave the masking tape on the model, capillary action will pull the paint underneath the masking tape and you won't have crisp edges. I had to be really careful pulling the masking tape off the body because the masking tape had wet paint and I didn't want it to brush up against any of the red areas on the body. I was creating quite a messy blob of the masking tape. I remasked the body for the blue paint and now I'm applying the blue. This is my collection of star decals from when I was doing military models. Some of these are Archer dry transfers, like these are Archer dry transfers, and these are dry transfers. I think there's some stars in here. And some are just regular water slide decals. So I guess I need 9 stars for the hood. Yeah, it looks like 9 for the hood, 3 for each side, 3 for this side. And this side has some faded stars under the black paint. So if I have any stars left over, I'll put them on here. And if not, I'm not sure what I'll do. I might save the water slides for these or something, I'm not sure. But the idea is I'm going to spray the black over the stars so the stars just kind of show through. We'll see how that works. What we're working with here are dry transfer decals, which I got from Archer, and these are probably 10 years old, and apparently you cannot get them anymore. I went to their website to try and get some more, and now they're doing all water slides. And I think that has something to do with some kind of EPA regulations. If anybody knows why it is that you can't get dry transfers anymore, please stick that in the bleep bloop section down there. I would love to have an answer to that. Anyway, what you do is you kind of put it in the right spot and then you burnish it onto the part with a little polished piece of wood here. The only thing tricky is you want to make sure you get the entire decal onto the part. And then after you've done that, you're going to want to spray it with some kind of a sealer like Tester's Dull Coat to just make sure it stays there. But it works out really well because there is absolutely no film, so it's a very clean looking decal. I didn't have enough dry transfer decals for the entire car, and if I wanted to buy more decals from Archer, it would have ended up costing about as much as what I paid for the kit. So I'm going to some water slide decals for the sides of the car here. These are just left over from previous kits and I'm applying them using the Microset and Microsol set of decal solutions. You can see on the rear of the car, there's a spot where the white paint was pulled off from the masking tape. I ended up repainting over that, so you don't see that on the final build. After the decals, it's yet another layer of tester's dull coat, and now I'm masking off the area to spray on the black for the captain's side fenders. You can see that I've already sanded through some of the white to reveal the red underneath. I was experimenting, so I didn't film it at the time. You can also see that I kind of cheated the stars on the black side. After seeing the final build, I kind of wish I hadn't done that. I'm spraying them over with Tester's Aircraft Interior Black. This is kind of a charcoal black, it's not a pure black. I try to avoid using pure black because not much in real life is true black. Now that I was satisfied that I was actually going to be able to get the stars and stripes onto the body, I proceeded with painting the interior pieces and some of the accessories, and I'm just painting all of this stuff black as a base coat. My mistake here is that I really should have cut the parts off of the trees and sanded away all the flash lines before I painted them. The wheels and the bumpers in the kit were chrome plated. But I thought the chrome was going to be too shiny for this build. So first I painted all the pieces with Tamiya gray primer. And then I painted them all with a black primer from Vallejo. You're supposed to use the black as a base coat for their metal color. Now I'm painting on Vallejo dark aluminum. I think this really helped. I don't think the build would have looked as good if I'd have left these parts chrome. The AMT kit is an SS model, so it has this SS emblem on the front grille. Here I'm doing my best to remove it. I really should have done this before I painted everything, but I didn't notice it until afterwards. There was also an SS emblem on the rear bumper, but I didn't notice it until near the end of the build, so it is still there. The whole front and rear ends are pretty significantly different from the real car anyway. In the original car, as he first picked it up, I don't think there even was a front grille. I thought about trying to replicate that, but I decided to go with this method instead. I wanted to wear through the stars on the hood, so I'm using a Tamiya sanding sponge. I'm using a 400 grit and then following that up with 1000 grit. I ran out of the right size stars using the dry transfers, so the three stars down the middle of the hood are slightly larger than the others. Of the stars that I used, the ones that looked like they were the best size were about 11 millimeters in size. Of course, after doing all the sanding, you're going to want to wash off all the dust using some dish detergent and warm water. Going back to the stripes, I'm sanding through some of the white to reveal the red underneath. This is why I put on so many layers of Tester's dull coat. It was to give me some protection against over-sanding, but it really made my job harder because it took a lot of sanding to get any of the paint to show through. I'm using silver paint for the interior of the headlights and also for the dials on the dashboard. Trying to paint the engine like the final engine in the Chevelle build was going to be too ambitious for me. I painted more subdued colors as it might have come from the factory. I'm going to add a lot of grime to it, so it's not going to be really obvious what the original color was anyway. Pretty much the entire bottom of the car is going to get a rust texture, so I don't know why I'm being careful painting just the exhaust at this step. I used the bottom of the car as an opportunity to practice some rust techniques for when I had to paint the rust on the body. So here I'm applying some rust colors with a sponge. This is AK Interactive's corrosion texture, and I've used it on several different projects, and I was never really happy with it, and I wasn't happy with it on this project. There's just something about the grit texture that just doesn't seem right. Like maybe it was too coarse, or there just wasn't enough grit in the mixture, I'm not sure. When I was a kid, I think we used to use baking soda for rust texture, but I don't remember how we glued it onto the model. So now we get to rusting the body, and the first thing I'm using is Vallejo Rust Texture, which is an acrylic product. It has a little bit of texture in it, but it's not really very noticeable. I'm mostly using it as a base coat and an indicator of where I'm going to be putting the rust. You can tell from the bottle that I use this one a lot. I really like it, and I think it's worth getting even if you have to pay the Evil Bay shipping fees. I started out applying it with a brush, but that was really taking too long, so then I decided to go to a sponge. The next step is applying rust colors with a sponge. Apparently, one of these colors that I really like, Americana Rookwood Red, has been discontinued. I can't find it anymore, and there's not even a spot for it on the paint rack. Now I'm applying rust-colored pigments. I do this by dipping the brush in some paint thinner and then into the pigment and applying the pigment to the car. When you're rusting a vehicle like this, you want to build it up in layers. It's always possible to add more rust, but it's pretty much impossible to remove it without just starting over. The rust pigments that I just added were way too orange. They were kind of like this, but all over the place. And I didn't really show it for some reason, but I just took a Kleenex and put it in some thinner and wiped most of it off, which is one of the nice things about pigments. The downside of pigments is that they dry different than they look when they go on wet. The good side is you can remove them a little bit. And then that's one of the reasons that I use layers of Tester's Dull Coat before I apply the pigments, is that I can remove it with the paint thinner and not worry too much about the paint underneath being damaged. So this is where it looks now. Not entirely sure what I want to do next. Probably spray it with some dull coat and then maybe do a little bit more. Kind of want to darken up some of the areas. But I think it looks okay. It doesn't sound very convincing, I guess, but we'll see what happens. Well, it's a mystery just what is going on the rear trunk roof with all the circles. So I'm going to try and recreate that with this little pipe. And it looks like the circles are gray, black, red, maybe some other colors. You know, practice on the underside of the hood, which doesn't really work. Have to do kind of a roll, I guess, to get the entire surface. I had glued in the windshield using super glue gel, but it was kind of in the wrong position, so now I'm trying again with 5-minute epoxy. Fortunately, I was able to rip the windshield out. The super glue really glued itself to the paint, so the bond was only as strong as the paint to the plastic, and that's why I was able to rip it out. That's why you're supposed to remove paint before you glue any two surfaces together. That is, of course, unless you think you're going to have to rip it apart at some time in the future. Here I'm trying to add a little more epoxy to glue the windshield into the body, and really it was kind of pointless. It just made a mess and didn't really do anything to strengthen the bond. The instructions were a little unclear about exactly where to position the firewall, so I took my best guess and I think I got it pretty close. This is where some car building experience helps. Then I do a test fit of the interior, and maybe you're supposed to glue the interior in before you put in the firewall. But I made it work without too much trouble. Now I'm using 5-minute epoxy to glue the interior to the body. It took a couple of attempts because I kept getting glue on different surfaces where I didn't want it and it was visible, so I had to wipe it off and start over. Apparently, I reversed the red and blue seats. The captain's side seat is supposed to be red. I think Derek's going to have to swap his seats to match my model. I gave the dash a little bit of weathering with this AK Interactive decay deposits. This is another area where some car building experience helps. Apparently, the wheels have to be on the chassis before you put the body onto the chassis. You can't get the body onto the chassis and then get the wheels on. And in the process of trying to get the body onto the chassis, the rear bumper came off. And another little area where experience probably helps is the metal rod for the axle is too long and needs to be cut off to make the wheels fit. I didn't notice any reference to that in the instructions. I guess it's just something that you know after building these kits for a while. After rusting the bottom of the chassis, I gave most of it a coat of this Vallejo brown engine soot. The stuff is a little bit transparent and it gave it a nice, worn, crusted look. In the process of trying to get everything to fit, the air cleaner kept coming off. And here goes the bumper again. Getting the body onto the chassis was harder than getting Keira Knightley to drop the restraining order. Things just weren't going right. It took about 6 attempts. Here, things are still not fitting right, and there goes the air cleaner again. And the problem was that the radiator was not centered on the frame exactly. So I'm cleaning it up and re-gluing it. I think one of the problems here was I was just trying to rush too many steps here, and I really needed to wait for the glue to dry on some of these steps before the final assembly. I never did actually glue the body to the chassis. I guess it just kind of sits there. I couldn't really find a surface to glue it to. That little fiasco led to some glue spots, so I'm covering them up with Tester's Doll Lacquer. Now I just need to paint on some final details and do some touch-up painting. This kit turned out better than I expected. I actually thought it was going to be a pretty big disaster, and the final kit actually looks pretty good. I do wish I was able to do something that more closely resembled the actual car, but I'm just not that familiar with what's out there in terms of parts for these vehicles. And the way that this kit is engineered, it just doesn't seem that it's well suited to the extensive customization needed for this build.